Thank you. So thank you very much. It's only my second time in Montevideo, but I'm as glad as being here as the people who are here for the eighth time, I hope so. I thank you for inviting me. I have nothing new to explain. So I will tell you about the problems I like. I will tell you about two problems, but I won't give you the solution. So the first problem, and both are related. First problem is a problem about random walks on compact groups and about speed of equidistribution. So let me first tell you what I know about random walk on compact groups. This is somehow very classical for people in group theory, but maybe not everybody handles easily group theory. So I will take G, which is a compact group, which means a group equipped with a topology which makes it a compact space and which makes the operation of the group continuous. And the only two examples I will be interested in will be the following. So the circle group and SO3, the group of orientation preserving isometries of three-dimensional Euclidean space. And you can, if you don't like compact groups, you can just think to these two examples. And now I will take mu. Mu will be a probability measure, a Borel probability measure on G. And I want to see mu as the law of a random walk, which means that I want to define a Markov process, a Markov chain on G. That is just a Markov chain on a space is just a rule to move randomly. Okay, it's just what it is. So when I am at a point X, this guy I see as a point in the group, and I pick G, an element in G, so which is a translation, and I choose it randomly with respect to the lu mu. I pick it at random, and I jump to GX. And then I iterate, that is, I pick a new element, etc., and I jump. And in probability theory, when you have a Markov chain, you like to define operators which represent the Markov chain acting on functions. So here's the operation. If I take just a continuous function on the group, I will define an operator. So P phi evaluated at x is just the integral of phi of gx. D mu of g. That means if I start from the point x, I look at all the possible destinations of the random movement and average the value of my function. Okay? And now, if you look at the random walk after n step, its distribution is given by the nth iterate of the operator. This integral over z to the n. It tells you, on average, where I am after n steps of the random walk. And you can ask, so saying that the random walk equidistributes is saying how this integral behaves for large n. Okay? So it's a, let's call it a proposition. This is a really classical from the elementary analysis on groups that if for every H, which is a proper closed subgroup of G, my probability measure is not concentrated on H. Of course, if I live on a subgroup, I have to study what happens on orbits of the subgroup. Then, for any continuous function, if I look at the Birkhoff sum, the Birkhoff average of the images by the operator of the function, this converges to the integral. So my random walk equidistributes in the Birkhoff sense. So this converges to an integral, which is just the integral towards the R measure of G. That is, what is this R measure? If you don't like, if you know it, you understand. If you don't know it, just have to think to these two examples. here, this is the R measure. This is just the Lebesgue measure of the circle. Yeah, in this case, you can look at SO3, just at acting on the sphere. Okay, and it acts on the sphere, and it acts transitively on the unit tangent bundle of the sphere. So the R measure is just the product of the round measure of the sphere and the Lebesgue measure on each unit circle above it. It's just what the... Yes?
What is the role of H in the proposition?
Sorry? I say that your measure, your random walk on the group, it must not live on a closed subgroup. Because if it lives on a closed subgroup, you cannot equidistribute everywhere. Okay, but this is what I'm saying is that the only obstruction to going everywhere is living on a closed subgroup. As soon as it is not true, it's okay. For example, this theorem, this proposition tells you that if you take an irrational rotation, you have an equidistribution. This is what it tells you. Okay, and now let me make a more, if moreover, so you will prefer to study these are, you see, as soon as you are not a translation of the group, you already have a lot of guys at every step, and you would ask whether they equidistribute or no. And the answer is that there is only one obstruction. This is just that, so let me write it. If moreover, for any H which is now a closed, a proper, normal subgroup, of G, the measure, and for any x in G, the measure of the left or right coset, this is the same, is smaller than 1, then actually you don't have to make a Birkhoff average. For any phi, which is a continuous function on the group, if you look at the distribution of the random walk after n step, so this is a uniform convergence, yeah? And in the same way, now, I don't have to make a Birkhoff average. I just go to the integral of phi, uniform. Again, because precisely, if your probability measure is just a Dirac mass at a point, you cannot equidistribute after n step. You're just a transformation. So you cannot equidistribute. But what I'm saying, and if you are a Dirac mass in a quotient of the group, the same happens. But I'm saying that this is the only obstruction. As soon as you are not saying that this measure is 1, it's exactly saying that my measure is just a Dirac mass in some quotient. And then it cannot equidistribute. But as soon as this is not true, you equidistribute. And now I will prove you this theorem in 3 lines. As I told you, this is really harmonic analysis. So, not example, it's proof. What happens is that you will consider the L2 space of the group. And when I write L2 of a group, I just mean with respect to R measure, which is, and this L2 space, it comes with an action of the group on itself, with the action of the group by, say, left translation. And here, everything acts on the left. So I consider the left action, my translation, on the group on itself. And I know that this space splits as a sum. So I will call it H. This is a Hilbert space. The name of a Hilbert space is H. So it splits as a direct sum, and each vi is G invariant and finite dimensional. This is where complexity comes into play, that every Hilbert unitary representation of a compact group is a direct sum of invariant finite dimensional subspaces. So if you don't trust this, if you're not familiar with this, you can think to finite groups, For a finite group, it's clearly true, because if you take any vector, its orbit spans a finite dimensional subspace. Okay. And the same happens for compact groups. And well, now, the invariant, the constant, the trivial representation only appears once, because you only have one constant function. Okay. So you can write it as C plus a sum Vi, and each Vi does not contain G invariant vector. But now these are G invariant subspaces, so they are invariant by the action of this operator here. So I have an operator, an operator P, Pi, which is a restriction of P to Vi. It has norm smaller than 1. And now, my assumption here, my first assumption, this is a small exercise. It is equivalent to saying that it has not 1 as an eigenvalue. So now it's just a property, an elementary property of linear algebra, that if you have an operator of norm smaller than 1, which does not admit 1 as an eigenvalue, necessarily, your Birkhoff average goes to 0. Okay. And the second assumption is equivalent to saying that P has no eigenvalue of modulus 1. And now, again, for the same reason, you know that P to the n goes to 0. If you have an operator which has norm 1, but which has no eigenvalue of the circle, all of the eigenvalues have modulus smaller than 1, so the power goes to 0, quick. So you see, this is, as soon as you know little of representation theory of compact groups, which is called the Peter Weiss theory, it's really easy. And now the key question is the question of the speed. So knowing the speed is knowing whether so this norm still goes to zero. This goes to zero as in norm. That is, what I'm proving here, it's what's called the strong convergence. Right? When you have an operator in a Banach space, you see that it converges strongly if for any vector. What I prove is this, okay? That I have a convergence of this form. But I didn't prove at the moment that the norm of Pn goes to zero. And this is the question. So let me give an example. So this is the question of spectral gap. That is, in other words, let me state it more precisely. On each of the Vi, you know that the eigenvalues are far away from the circle. But do you have a uniform bound? Okay, that is, as you have a sequence, an infinite sequence of operators in finite dimension. All of them have their eigenvalues far away from the circle, but maybe they could get closer and closer to the bound, to the circle. And in the circle, not the same circle, now when the group G is a circle, this is exactly what may happen. So let me say precisely what happens here. In this case, let me describe the Vi. You have the Fourier coefficient, ek of x. This is, you need some k at some point. So you have this Fourier coefficient, and this decomposition here, it is just the fact that the L2 of the circle is the sum over k of the space spanned by the function ek. Okay? So now, each of these functions, so these are the stable subspaces. So these are eigenvectors in this case. In the abelian case, this is a decomposition into line. And what I'm saying it for the circle, but it works for any non-discrete abelian. And now I have a formula which is just almost trivial. This vector is an eigenvector. And what is the eigenvalue? This is the Fourier transform of the measure. Okay, mu. I'm just writing something which is trivial. Okay, it's just the Fourier transform. This decomposition here, it is, in the case of circles, this is just Fourier series. And what happens is that, for example, if mu is absolutely continuous to Lebesgue, you have Riemann-Lebesgue lemma, which tells you that these Fourier coefficients, they go to zero. So you have the speed here. You equidistribute quickly, because the eigenvalues, they don't go close to the circle, they go close to zero. So you are sure to equidistribute quickly. But when mu is finitely supported, so you take a finitely supported measure on the circle, it's really easy to prove that there exists. So this coefficient, if you take a probability measure, which does not live on a finite subgroup of the circle, these coefficients, when k is not zero, they are different from 1. And they have modulus smaller than 1. But when mu is finitely supported, it's really easy to build a sequence kl such that mu, the Fourier transform, goes to 1, actually. So in this case, you know that there is never a spectral gap. Equidistribution is slow, okay, for finitely supported measure. And the question now, which is still open, is about what happened in this case. In the case of SO3. In the case of SO3, so it is a conjecture. Sorry? What measure?
No measure that they are not finite is a problem.
Depends on the measure. Everything can happen. Everything can happen. So the conjecture, which maybe can be attributed to Cernak, is that for any probability measure mu on SO3, so I write SO3, I could give you a bunch of spaces where it is probably true, so where one can hope it to be true, but I prefer to focus on simple examples, okay? Such that for any H included in G, so this will be G, proper subgroup, proper closed subgroup, mu is not concentrated in G, mu has a spectral gap. You see, again, this is just, I'm just giving you, when I give you a measure, the question is just associated to the measure comme a sequence of finite dimensional vector spaces equipped with a sequence of operators with norm smaller than 1 and with no eigenvalue, so more than that, no eigenvalue modulus 1, is there a bound on the way the eigenvalues can come close to the circle? Okay. So here I didn't put the second assumption about normal subgroups because there are no non-trivial normal subgroups in SO3, which is a simple group. Okay. So let me describe you so that you understand what the proper subgroups of SO3 are. It's really easy. Huh? So you have proper subgroups of SO3. These are just the rotation around the given axis. If I fix you a given axis, you have the rotations around this axis, and you have the stabilizers of regular polyhedra. These are the maximal. These are the maximal. It's difficult to draw an icosahedron or a dodecagon, so I won't do it. Okay, dodecagon. Okay. And so the stabilizers are the maximal proper subgroups of SO3. So what I'm saying is that now you take, let me really state an elementary case of the conjecture, which is First I should say in which cases the conjecture is known to hold. So since last 10 years, there have been some progress on this conjecture. And there is a theorem by Bourguin and Gamburd. I don't know, maybe it's 2005, I'm not sure of the exact, maybe 2007, I don't recall exactly. And it says that it is true if mu is finitely supported, or countably supported, and leaves on matrices with algebraic entries. So you take any finite set of matrices with algebraic coefficients, and these are 3x3 matrices, so you take matrices with algebraic coefficients, you put weights on them, and then you assume that they have not a common axis, or they don't fix a common regular polyhedron. Then you have this operator, this average of the action of the element, and this has the spectral gap. And to my knowledge, it is not true in any other case. So for example, let me state an open case. I take G, which is a G's matrix. And H, so these are, I'm fixing just two coordinate axes, and I'm rotating with angle theta around one, and rotating with angle theta around the other. Okay. And for small theta, so I know that there is no common axis, and for small theta, you are sure not to preserve a regular polyhedron. So for small theta, you take, for example, mu, so I prefer symmetric measures. So. Nicer to have symmetric measure because this makes self-adjoint operators better. And you can ask, so you have this operator, so just the operator is the average of the action of these four elements. Does it have a spectral gap or no? It's not known. Okay. So this is the first problem. And so now let me go to another field, which is also a field, group theory with probability measures. And I will ask questions, and we will see that they are actually related to these ones. It's not that far away, the other field, nevertheless. So now I will change the group, and I will take G to be SL2R. So this is a group of unimodular 2x2 matrices. And again, I will take mu, which will be a probability measure. And now, again, I want to study again the random walk on G associated to mu. And again, there are some non-degeneracy assumptions. I want to, you see here, I didn't want to consider matrices with the same axes or preserving a discrete structure. So I will assume that for any H, which is included in G, but which is a proper algebraic subgroup, mu is not concentrated on H. And again, you see this assumption, when you see it in this way, it seems complicated, but concretely, it's very easy to check. If I give you an explicit set of matrices, you can check, because you know the maximal proper subgroups. SL2, it is the same. So what is the maximal? What are the maximal proper algebraic subgroups of SL2R? There are three conjugacy classes. The first Cornelius AEC class is the class of SO2. So you are, when you ask this, you ask that the measure does not leave an orthogonal isometries for a certain fixed scalar product. You have the group of upper triangular matrices. So you are assuming that the matrices in the support of mu do not have a common eigenvector. Okay. And you just have the union of the set of diagonal and anti-diagonal matrices. This is a subgroup. And I'm just assuming that I don't have a common pair of lines that is invariant. Just so you see, it's really easy to check if I give you a set of matrices to check whether it holds or not. And now this group, SL2R, so it is not compact. So what will happen is that if I take a trajectory of a random walk, it will go to infinity under this assumption. Okay, just as it, and even with the speed, it will, there is a Lyapunov exponent, which is positive somewhere, etc. But I won't speak of this today. I'm interested in the properties of equidistribution, so I will look at the action of SL2R on a compact space, which is just the projective line. So topologically, this is just a circle. This is a set of vector lines in R2. And now this is a compact space. So again, I will define an operator with the same formula. And now I define it on functions, continuous functions on P1. And now you can ask what happens with respect when I iterate this operator on the functions on P1. That is, if I start with a point on the boundary, where does it go? And it turns out that it goes to a fixed measure, it distributes to a fixed measure. So this is a theorem of Furstenberg. I don't know, in the 60s somehow. But there exists nu, which is a probability measure on P1. Such that for any phi, when I look at this distribution after n step, p phi, this goes as n goes to infinity uniformly. In particular, phi is nu. Is a unique p-invariant measure. It has a unique p-invariant measure. So, if for example, you have your measure lives on a guise which contracts in different directions on a kind of IFS, you will have a measure on some contour subset of P1. And as regards questions related to speed, etc., what happens is well known. That is, but here the situation is very different. And, one knows how that there is a speed in a certain space of Hölder continuous functions or things like it. Okay. And, the question I would like to address are questions about the geometry of the measure nu, and there are open problems. And so, for example, there is a theorem that is what is this measure? And you see, it's defined by a in a totally non-explicit form. You don't have an so in certain cases, you have an integral formula or things like it. But in general, the proof of this theorem is really a proof ad absurdum. You suppose that there are several measures, and then you reach a contradiction. And so you don't have an explicit formula for defining nu. So it's rather difficult to handle. Nevertheless, there is, for example, a theorem by Givarch, which tells you that if mu is compactly supported. Actually, you can suppose a bit less, but let's say it's the law, the random walk on the group. One has to be careful because there are two probability measures. So it's difficult. One is mu, this is the distribution of the random walk on the group. Okay? And nu is a limit distribution on the projective line. Okay? I will keep to these notations until the end. So if the distribution is the increments of the random walk on the group live in a compact set, then new has positive Hausdorff dimension. Let me cite a recent advance. So this is, I don't know, maybe 97, 95, I don't know. I don't remember. Let me cite a recent result by Lee, 2000, maybe 17, that under the same assumption, the Fourier transform of nu goes to zero at infinity. So you equip the circle with the SO2 invariant matrix. So you see P1 just as a circle. So you can ask for the Fourier coefficient of the measure. And this is, it looks a little regular, that is, it satisfies Riemann-Lebesgue lemma. Even if it is absolutely, even if it is concentrated on a zero measure Cantor set, it satisfies Riemann-Lebesgue lemma. Okay. And has this kind of information. And I would like to know whether when can I ensure that nu is absolutely continuous. So, of course, again, if mu is itself is absolutely continuous, then nu will be absolutely continuous. It's rather easy to prove. But in general, one doesn't know, even if mu is finitely supported. So it's not very clear. But at least there are cases where the group spanned by the support of the measure is dense enough for the probability measure. So the group spanned by the support of mu is dense enough in some way for the probability measure nu, the distribution, the limit distribution, to be absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure. So there is a theorem, said by Bourguin. Again, I don't know, I didn't prepare this talk very carefully because I didn't check any bibliographical reference. So maybe it's, let me put a random date, something like it. Less than 20, less than 5, more than 20 years. So which tells you that there exists mu, which is finitely supported. So again, which does not give mass to any proper algebraic subgroup, etc. On SL2. Such that nu is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure. And so there were previous constructions, but they were random. That is, they were modeled on the proof that for almost every parameter, Bernoulli convolution are absolutely continuous. And we knew that there were examples, but they were not explicit. Whereas this example is explicit. So at least, if you are able to read the paper by Bourguin, which selects a particularly small subset of humanity, but they are supposed to be explicit. And so I don't understand this paper. I am not able to do it again. But at some point, we were reading it with Yves Benoit, and we understood the strategy. So I would like to explain you the strategy. And how it is connected to properties of spectral gap, etc. So what is the strategy? To understand the strategy, I need to talk a little about functional analysis. So we can forget, if you didn't like what was before, maybe we like it now, because I will change topic. So now I will do, as Andres did this, there is a smirkel. We change topic. And so I will speak about operators in Banach spaces and about spectral radius And there is another spectral radius for there are two spectral radii for an operator, and one is called the essential spectral radius. So I would like to talk a little about this. So let me start slowly. So I will take E, which is a Banach space. So in the sequence, this will be a space of functions on the circle. Just L2 space of the circle for the Lebesgue measure. And T, which is a bounded Lania operator in E. So when I have a Banach space and the bounded Lania operator, I can build its spectral spectrum. So the spectrum of T, it is just a set of complex numbers such that lambda minus T is not invertible. So in finite dimensions, this is just the space, the set of eigenvalues of T. Okay. So in any dimension, what is known is that it is a non-empty compact subset of C. So you have somewhere associated to your operator. You have a subset. Maybe it is not connected. Maybe it has isolated point. Yeah. You have a subset. And the spectral radius of T, it is just the supremum of the moduli of the people living in the spectrum. So you have zero somewhere, and you draw. This is supposed to be a circle. Now, you take this radius. This is the spectral radius. You have and these objects are defined actually in any Banach algebra. Here, the underlying Banach algebra is just the algebra of bounded operators. I'm leaving. This is just the language of spectrum and spectral radius in the algebra of bounded operators. Algebra of bounded operators is my Banach space. The algebra of bounded operators. And so in the infinite dimensional case, what happened is that this algebra has an ideal. This is not true. In finite dimension, the algebra of matrices is a simple algebra. It has no proper ideal. Okay? But here, it has an ideal. See, the ideal is the ideal of compact operators. So if you don't like compact operators, you will like them in half an hour first. And for the moment, you can think to E as being a Hilbert space. In this case, a compact operator is just a norm limit of finite rank operators. Okay. So this is an operator which has a very small image. Okay. So in the Hilbert space case, it is just a limit of finite rank operators. But what is really nice, you see, if you have an operator T, and S has finite rank, or S is compact, but so what is nice is that it is an ideal. And if you think to them as being more or less finite rank operators, it's clear. Because if S has finite rank, TS and ST have finite rank. Okay. So it is an ideal. Okay. It is a closed ideal. So you have a Banach algebra, and you have a ring. You have a nice ideal, a closed ideal, because there is topology here. So there is a quotient. So if you like names, I think it is called the Calkin algebra. That is the quotient of the algebra of bounded operator by the ideal of compact operator. And this is a proper ideal, because now my space has infinite dimension. Okay. Calkin algebra. So again, if you take an element, T, it has a spectrum. Sigma E of T. It is the spectrum, not the spectrum of T, but the spectrum of the image of T in this quotient ring. Okay? So this is called the essential spectrum. When you take a quotient, it's easier to be invertible here than to be invertible in the large ring. Okay? So this is a subset of the full spectrum. It's an empty subset. And you have also a new spectral radius,
the essential spectral rays.
So, an operator which is invertible modulo the compact operators, T is invertible in the quotient algebra, it is called a Fredholm operator. Maybe you know this terminology, standard terminology in functional analysis. So you can also define, if you don't like quotient rings, you can define sigma e of t as being the set of complex numbers lambda, such that lambda minus t is not a Fredholm operator. And what is really fascinating to me, which I still don't understand, is that actually you can, so you have here, you have an inclusion. And this inclusion may be proper. In some cases it is not, in some cases it is. And when it is proper, it means that somewhere you have the spectrum, the essential spectrum. And you have a larger circle. So when, I'm not saying it's not when this inclusion is proper, it's that when the essential spectral radius is smaller than the spectral radius. And you have eigenvalues which are outside of the essential disk. Here, my picture is not right. This is a true spectral radius, and here you have the essential spectral radius. And it's really easy to describe what are the spectral values which are out of the essential disk. This is just an abstract phenomenon from functional analysis that if you have lambda, which is in the spectrum, but the modulus of lambda is larger than the essential spectral radius, then actually it is an eigenvalue. This is a spectral values are difficult to handle in higher dimension, in infinite dimension, because they are not eigenvalues. But actually these are. Okay. So what do I mean precisely? That there exist F and G, which are which are closed subspaces of my binary space. F is finite dimensional. And E is just the sum of F plus G. And both spaces are stable under my operator. The spectrum. So now the action of T on F is just a finite dimensional operator. Okay, the spectrum of T on F is just lambda. And the spectrum of T restricted to J, it is just the spectrum of T deprived of lambda. So this is why I draw this picture in this way. You have these eigenvalues here, and in fact you have countably many. So is the space is separable? And they will accumulate towards this circle. So it's really easy to describe. When you have the luck to find an operator for which the essential spectral radius is smaller than the spectral radius, you very well know what happens in this disk. Okay. And this is just abstract functional analysis. Yes, because you see, this property tells you that lambda is an isolated point on the spectrum. Okay. Actually, what happens is that the true statement to these two holes is lambda has to be in the same connected component of the complement of this essential spectrum as infinity. It has to be in the infinite component. Just full statement. But this is a very nice looking statement, but in practically the only way of checking this is checking this. Okay. So the picture is not this. The picture is that even if you have an eigenvalue here, it will equidistribute to the essential spectrum. So now, let me go back to the proof of Bourguin's theorem about absolutely continuous stationary measures. So what we did with Yves Benoit was that we read his paper and we understood at some point that there were some formulae, and actually this is what he was doing, even if he was not stating it explicitly. So this is somehow a very weak talk because I'm explaining you what I understood in the proof of Bourguin. So it's still kind of an achievement, but so let me state a proposition. Assume, so I'm back to the notation. I'm back to probability measures on SL2 and stationary measures on P1, etc. So I need just to introduce the space on which I want to do functional analysis. So I will fix rho. This will be the Lebesgue measure on P1. So of course, it's cheating you because there are several choices which are possible, but the SO2, which is SO2 invariant. So now, I'm not cheating anybody. So unique, so this is just, you parameterize P1 by the angle between lines, okay? And I will, E will be called H because it will be a Hilbert space. It is the L2 of P1 for the measure. So here is a proposition, which is proved in the paper of Bourguin, that assume that my operator P, always the same operator, the operator of convolution by the measure, has essential spectral radius smaller than 1 in H. So it is you see, I will assume mu, I will always assume mu to be compactly supported. But you see, because my group G, my group SL2, it acts on this Hilbert space by composition of the functions. But it does not preserve the measure, okay? So it acts by bounded operators. So if you want to define P and be sure that it is really a bounded operator of this space, you have to be careful. You have to make some assumption on the support of the measure. You can assume less, but you are sure that if it is compactly supported, then you get a bounded operator on this space, okay? But now I have my bounded operator, and I assume that its essential spectral radius is smaller than 1. Then, nu is absolutely continuous to rho, and with density in L2. That is, I will build, if I know this, I will build my stationary measure as an element of this space. And the proof is very easy. Because what happens is that you consider your operator P. So what you know is that P preserves the constant function. This is an invariant vector for all the group. So you know that the 1 belongs to the spectrum of T. P, sorry. But now, the spectrum of an operator is the same as the spectrum of its adjoint operator. So you also know that 1 belongs to the spectrum of the adjoint operator. And the same holds for the essential spectrum. So the essential spectrum of an operator is the same as the essential spectrum of its adjoint operator. Again, it's elementary functional analysis. So you know that it is smaller than 1. So now I know that I have a spectral value with, for the adjoint operator, I have a spectral value with modulus larger than the essential spectrum. So I know that it is an eigenvector by the proposition here. So there exists some function f in H, which is invariant by the adjoint operator. And this is exactly saying, in other words, saying this is exactly saying that the measure f rho, the measure which is absolutely continuous to rho with density f, is p invariant. Okay. So by uniqueness, I know that my measure lives in H. Okay. slightly magical because you don't see anything. So you have, I was a little quick here because you don't know that it is a positive measure, but it's really easy to prove that if this sine measure is invariant, its absolute value is also invariant because the operator is positive. Okay, so this is how he proves it. So now, of course, there is work still to be done because you have to produce an example of this situation. The key proposition, which I won't prove, in the paper by Bourguin, is that there exists mu finitely supported on SL2R. Such that P has essential spectral radius smaller than 1 and H. So just actually what we did with Yves Benoit is that we understood this part of the proof, and then we were able to prove the same statement in SLD. But it's easier in SLD for D at least 3, because you use the fact that anyway, it's easier. So this is the most difficult case, actually, and we are not able to do it, okay? But, because, so it's difficult. So, the point is that, so what is the strategy of Bourguin? So, strategy is based on sum product estimates and additive combinatorics. But one part of the proof is to change actually the operator, to replace it by another operator. I don't know how much time I have left. Or
10 minutes.
10 minutes, oh. I've been much better than usually. So you see, to define my operator P, I define the action of an element on a function. So you have to be careful when groups act on spaces of functions. You have to be put inverses at some places. So let us write it this way. This is how I let the group act on the function on the space. Okay, for a function f, which was a function in L2 of P1, which I denoted by H. This is how, and then I took an average to define my operator P. And you see, this is not a very good action, because it is not an action by unitary automorphisms. Okay? So usually in group theory, when you consider this space, what you do is that you act through this formula. This is not a good formula. The good formula is to act, but to here you add a term which is the Radon, which is a derivative. Here, this is a derivative with respect to the SO2 invariant metric. This is a positive number because I'm in SL2 and SL2 preserves the orientation. And just by the change of variable formula, now this operator, this is a unitary operator on the space. Okay. And what happens is that in the construction of Bourguin, the support of this finitely supported measure here is very close to the identity. It spans a dense subgroup, actually, but it is very close to the identity. So this derivative is very close to 1. So if you define a new operator, if you define QF to be the operator Now, I define the operator, but by using the twisted action, which is an action by unitary automorphism of this L2 space. Here, you have a much better operator, which looks exactly as the operators I was using in the case of compact groups, because it is an average of isometries. Okay, so it's a much better operator. But what happens is that when the support of mu goes to the identity, the norm, the operator norm of p minus q goes to zero. Because this term here, it is a function which goes to one. Okay. So if you are able to prove that q has a central spectral radius uniformly, if you have a family, what Bourguin proves is that he constructs a sequence. This is why I told you that in some way his construction is explicit, but still it's difficult to follow the constant. But because he constructs a sequence of measures whose support converge to zero, to the trivial element. And what he proves is that the limit, as n goes to infinity, of the operators Qn, of the spectral radii, is smaller than one, essential spectral radii. So he knows that the same holds for P, just by continuity. Okay. And actually, in his constructions, so we don't have any counterexamples. We don't know if you take measures on SL2, we don't know how to compute this thing in general. His construction is, of course, it's a very particular example. That is, his measures, these are measures supported on points with matrices with coefficients in Q. And the denominators will arise with respect with n, but slowly, etc. But in general, you don't know how to compute this. So I will just finish by asking questions which are related to this proof. That is, the question is an optimistic question. Is there does there exist epsilon such that for any mu, for any say, I have to be careful, else the question is the answer. You have to be careful, else the answer is clearly no. Okay. Such that for any GH in SL2R, which span a Zariski-Dent subgroup, that is, Zariski-Dent is just not contained in any proper algebraic group. Just to explain. If you set mu to be 1/4 so it is some kind. It is a version of the question by Sarnak about SL2. And the question of Sarnak for SO3 is a kind of version in SL2. If I define Q as above by this formula, the essential spectral radius of Q is smaller than 1 minus epsilon. I don't know if this is true. Less optimistic would be same question, but for G and H close to identity. And even less optimistic, G, you take it to be this matrix. Sorry, not cosinus. You take G to be this matrix. And so this is exactly the same question as I gave you explicit elements in SO3. Okay. Somehow I put the same elements here. So this would be to take G, this guy, and H would be this guy. This is just, these two people are conjugate, actually. And you take these two people, and you look. So for T small, so here's these people, it's very easy. This is just G. You have the canonical basis, and G is diagonalizable. And to build H, you rotate. And this is what H is. Okay. And here you see, you don't have a common eigenbasis. You don't have it's really easy to check that they span the Zariski-Dent subgroup. Okay. And for small t, you look to this measure. And what is it's clear that the spectral radius will go to 1. Because the measure is closer and closer to identity. So necessarily the spectral radius goes to 1. But the question is, how does it go to 1? That is, it is, so you have, it is a self-adjoint operator. because I act by isometries and my major is symmetric. So it is a self-adjoint operator in a Hilbert space. So you have some spectrum, and it will fill the interval. At least it will go to one, because the element go to identity. But it's not clear how it fills it. Do you have more and more eigenvalues, or do you have really fat parts of the spectrum? I really don't know. I have no idea. Okay. And if you know that actually what it does, what appears in the construction by Bourguin is examples where this is what happens. The fat part stays far away from one, and you have more and more eigenvalues here. So you know that the essential spectral radius stays far away from one. In particular, you know that the stationary measure is absolutely continuous. Okay. So same question. So either you ask the spectral question or just the question about stationary measure. Is it true that the stationary measure of this random walk is absolutely continuous? Okay. Thank you very much. Yes, with finite, yes. So, of course, if you mean a densely supported singular measure.
Yeah.
There is an example. It is due to Kaimanovich, and I don't remember the other guy. And the idea is just you take measure of this form, and but you put more and more weight, and you take two guys. You put a measure on this form. You take a very large G. And a very small h. And you take this measure. And you see what will happen is that as a goes to 1, yes, and you have you use Le Drapier-Young formula to relate dimension with exponents. And you have a formula for the Lyapunov exponent. So you know that when a goes to 1, in the end, what you get is a Lyapunov exponent of g only. And you look at what it tells you with respect to dimension, you know that the dimension will be smaller than 1. Okay. Yes. But easier to state, but much more difficult to prove. Yes. What Bourguin actually does is that you see, actually, this technique is very supple. So you can prove this, do the same thing in solved OLF spaces. So you see because the argument is that again, when you take measures which are very close to the identity, the difference between the unitary operator and the operator for the Sobolev norm is very small. So actually, you prove a spectral gap in a Sobolev space with arbitrary high regularity. So you know that you are absolutely continuous with arbitrarily smooth density.
When choosing the closed subgroups of SL2R,
yes? Because when you live in an algebraic subgroup, the situation is very different. It's just that I know how to handle this. These are very degenerate situations. If you take a random walk as a diagonal group, it would be stupid to forget that you live in the diagonal group. It's just what I mean. Okay. Because what happens in SL3, so you want me to tell you about our results, that's very nice from you. And what happens in SL3 is that in SL3, what you do is that you follow the same strategy. And the problem is here, to build an example of a measure. But in SL3, you have SO3. And on SO3, you have measures which have a spectral gap. There are examples. We find at least supported measures with a spectral gap. So now you take one and you add a small thing. So to make it the Zariski dense, which SL3 is the maximal algebraic subgroup of SL3. So as soon as you add anything, you are Zariski dense. But still, since what you had is very small, more or less the spectral radius looks like the spectral radius of this. So you have essential spectral radius smaller than one. Okay. So, but the point in SL2, so that you can do in any simple Lie group except SL2. Because in any simple Lie group, the compacts, there are non-abelian compact simple groups. But in SL2, you only have SO2, and SO2 is not compact. You don't have spectral gap in SO2, as I explained at the beginning of the lecture.
Okay, let's think.